John 10:1.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbs up some other way, that same is a thief and a robber.
He said, you try to get in there any other way than the door, your butt is a thief and a robber. All right? Let's see what happens.
To him, the porter opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he call his own sheep by name, and leads them out. And when he puts forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice.
All right, for us, it's only one way in. All right, and it got to be by the Messiah. All right, the people that respond to his voice, and that's his word, right? The people that respond to the word, that's how we know that we're sheep. All right, that's what we have to want to be. We have to want to be sheep to the Messiah. The reason why he uses sheep in the parable, because we know sheep, they'll follow the next sheep. And whoever that next sheep is following, then you get to the top of that line where sheep is following the shepherd, right? The problem is that anybody come along or one sheep start following the next sheep and gets followed, you know, goes somewhere and gets led astray, then they go to doom, right? That's what happened to the sheep. So the shepherd would have to try to keep them all together, right? We got a lot of people out here calling themselves shepherds but lead sheep in the wrong direction, right? And that's what we need to do. We need to be able to look at each other and follow one another as we follow Yahushua. Alright? Because Yahushua is the only true shepherd. We try to get in any other way, we done. We try to run our mouth talking about we saved because we believe, we done. If our obedience don't line up with our belief. Alright? We try to go here and say, you know, I'm a Muslim. You know what I'm saying? We done. Alright? So you're trying to get in there a whole other way. Talking about you're going to have 10 virgins when you die. After you do your sacrifice of yourself. You know what I'm saying? Your terrorist event. Blow yourself darn up. Alright, all that stuff is foolish. Books say it ain't no. Grab a. What is it? Matthew. Is it 17? No, the angels are not going to be given in the marriage.
Is it 10?
Okay, Matthew 10. Okay, Matthew 17. Yeah, even the book, Yahushua told it. He said, you know what I'm saying, it's going to be just like it is in the kingdom. You know what I'm saying? The angels are not given into marriage. They don't marry nor are they given into marriage. And he said, we're going to be the same way. We're going to be just like the angel. So what it makes sense, you get 12 virgins when you go in. Right? These people have fed lies and they teach lies. Right? And you have sheep that follow the lies. Right, our job is to show and be a representation to the Most High God so that people will follow us as we follow Yahushua. That we'll be sheep and we can go in by the door. Otherwise, Revelation chapter 22, like verse, last verse is probably like 20 something, so give me like verse like 17. What's the last verse? What's the last verse you see there? Not the last verse in Revelation chapter 22,
21.
Give me like 17. So,
you probably want to, what we said, the dogs. Is it 22? It is, right? Is y'all feel what's talking? Or John?
So this is Revelation chapter 22, verse 15.
Yeah. So for without our dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loves them and maketh a lie.
Read that one more time.
Right, so we'll start at 12.
So this is Revelation chapter 22, verse 12.
And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they might have right to the tree of life. And
he said, blessed are they who do his commandments, because they don't have right to the tree of life. Remember, that's the same tree of life that was taken away from Adam and Eve when they didn't do his commandments. Right? So he's restoring life to them. All right, keep going.
And may enter through the gates into the city. Mm-hmm. For without our dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loves and make a lie.
Right? You love, make a lie. You're trying to get in the wrong way. You love and you make a lie. Give me chapter 21, though. I think 21 is the one I'm looking for. Give me chapter 21. Give me verse, maybe 3.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God.
Uh-huh.
God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write for these words are true and faithful.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is the thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. That overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son.
That's what's going to happen to the one that overcomes. What else?
But the fearful and the unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
Alright? You try to get in the wrong way, that's where you're going to land. Alright? That's what we try to do here. We just try to come, and we try to make sure that we make clear the understanding of the Most High God. You gotta understand that you can make a decision at that point. You can't make a decision without understanding. Right? You rock. A lot of these pastors, a lot of these teachers, a lot of these preachers, a lot of these people standing up, leading people, or call themselves leading people, they're robbing people. Right? They're a thief. They're a thief and a robber because you take away the opportunity for a person to make a correct decision by not giving them information. Right? One thing, you don't have it. You don't have that information, then you shouldn't take the position of a teacher, or a preacher, or a pastor. Alright? If you do have that information, that's even worse. You have that information, but you neglect to tell the people. That blood's on your hand. Alright, that's the book. Alright, it's important for us. We have to make sure we understand what we're doing. We have the information to make a correct decision towards the Most High God. Otherwise, we end up falling in traps. Alright? That's where it picks us up. Let's pick up where we left. we didn't really get into the details. We just kind of stuck to the narrative, right? We just talked about, you know, this is where the children of Israel were. This is where they went through the wilderness and they went into the land. We just kind of skimmed through the laws of it. But now we're going to get into the law and understand the details of the law, understand the commandments of the law, exactly what it's saying. Why are they coming up? What does it relate to? God willing, that's what we'll continue to do over the next few weeks until we complete the law, and then we'll go into more of the history and get back in the narrative. This is Exodus chapter 20. Go ahead and give me about verse 8. Talk about the Sabbath. He said, Remember
the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
Mm-hmm.
6 days you shall labor and do all your work.
Mm-hmm.
But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work.
Mm-hmm.
Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Mm-hmm. Right? He had to refer back to creation. Right, we don't have nothing. We have something for all, every little, you know, you got the year, you can track that with the sun, the day, you can track that with the sun, you can track the month with the moon, but when it comes to weeks, there's nothing in nature that you can track it by. Right? So when the Most High God referred to it, he had to refer back to creation. Right? He couldn't say look up at the sun, that's how you track the year. Grab Genesis chapter 1, verse, I don't know, 14 maybe. This is Genesis chapter 1, verse 14. Watch the difference. Might be 15, though, but Genesis chapter 1, verse 14.
God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night.
To divide the what?
Day from the night.
Okay. So he said, I want to divide day from the night. You know how I'm going to do that? I'm going to put a couple of lights in the firmament of the heaven. In space. That's what the firmament means. It's just an expanse. It's space. All right. So he said, I'm going to throw a couple of lights in space. Right? That's how I'm going to divide the day from the night. Right? What? Let's hear about it.
And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years.
So let's see. They're going to be for signs and for seasons. And for days and for years. Why didn't he say that about weeks? Alright? Keep going.
And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth, and it was so.
Alright? The lights he was talking about, the sun, the moon, right? You can use that. You can use that to track all that other stuff. Right? But when he talked about the Sabbath, and when he talked about a full week, there's only one thing he can refer to. Right? You can't say, look at the sun. No, I have to talk about when I created. Right? When I created. He did all that. Chapter 2. Give me chapter 2. Give me verse. Genesis chapter 2. Give me verse 1. Watch what he said.
Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made.
Right, so Jesus told that he rested on the seventh day. So when he gave us the commandment, he had to refer back to that. Like, y'all heard of this story? Well, yeah, this is why I'm telling y'all to rest on the seventh day. Right? Then he named it for it. He called it the Sabbath. You'll never read in the book. We got some names for months. We got some names for all types of stuff. But we don't have names for no week, no days. Right? The only day that we have a name for is the Sabbath. And the Most High God gave us that name. Right? A lot of times in Christianity, we've been made to take the Sabbath, the tradition, away from the Sabbath. Right? And put the tradition towards Sunday. Right? And we'll see Sunday as the day of rest. We'll see Sunday as the day that, oh no, I ain't working on Sunday. Let me tell you something. You try to get a Christian to work on a Sunday? That ain't crazy. Yeah, I mean, hey, make a darn man, I'm not working on the Sunday. Right? But that's the glory that belongs to the Sabbath, that God gave to the Sabbath. Right? The men gave it to Sunday. Right? That's what we've been taught to follow. So a lot of us, we just have been sheep towards the wrong shepherd. Right? And it's time for us to clean this stuff up. But they go in there, they'll put all their value. There's a lot of people won't even cuss. They cuss every other day. Don't make a mistake. They cussing every other day. On Sunday, don't even know like it's Sunday. They tell you too, it's like it's Sunday and you talking like that. Okay, but that's how they look at it. I mean, that's a holy day. They're trying to remember and keep it holy. Tomorrow, they messed up. They messed up the wrong day. Right? He said, remember the Sabbath. Right? Any calendar you look at, not any, some of them are wrong, but the calendars that you look at, you'll see the week start with Sunday. Right? So it's no excuse. It's not like anybody can look at it and be like, oh, I had no idea. Right? Everything we have, most like God didn't leave himself without a witness. Right? Not like you say, oh, I thought Sunday was the last day of the week. No, he didn't think that. And if you did, it's a Christian probably taught you that. Right? We look at these things. It's there for us. It's there for us to take. It's there for us to get the information. It's just a matter of when is the Most High God going to reveal it? Who is he going to reveal it to? To whom will he give this knowledge? Right? To whom will he make understand the doctrine? Right? Is it going to be those who wean from the breast and wean from the milk and drawn from the breast? All right, he said precept has to be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little there. For with stammering lips in another tongue, he will speak to this people. To whom he said, this is the rest, wherewith you will call the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, but they wouldn't hear. So the word of the Lord became unto them, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. All right? So that they go backwards, they fall back, what is it?
Might go fall backwards.
Broken the snare to take. That's a trap. Right? The whole thing set up for a trap. He's sitting there telling you, who am I going to teach it to? Right? Oh, and I do teach it, and you know what it's going to sound like? It's going to sound like I'm speaking another language to you. And you know why? Because if you don't hear it, your butt's going to go, and you're going to fall backwards. You're going to be broken. You're going to be trapped, and you're going to be taken. Right? The whole thing is a trap. Alright, that's why it's important for us to pay attention. He's speaking another language. We learn that language. Right? Everything we do, we have to be able to pick it up from the Most High God. Alright? That's why we read this law. There's a lot of stuff that's just been left in the wayside, just like, oh no, you don't need that Jesus. Right? Jesus, oh, that's all it's about. Jesus. If you ain't talking about Jesus, the whole book is him. The whole book is Yahushua. So you sitting here thinking that you're doing something special. I said, See, y'all focus on Moses. That's the old. That's the latter. He's in there. You think you're doing something special by doing that? You think you're showing God more glory by doing that? Whole time you cut off half his son. Right? You look at his son and just say, oh, now that's nothing. How you going to know the man if you don't know his history? If you don't know what he inspired before? If you don't know what testifies of? Right? That's what we try to do. We try to get here and just make sure we get some understanding. This is Matthew chapter 12. Give me verse 3. Matthew chapter 12, verse 3. We can learn about Sunday.
But he said unto them, have ye not read what David did when he was a hungered, and they that were with him?
Uh-huh.
How he entered into the house of God and did eat the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests.
Mm-hmm.
Or have you not read in the law how that on the Sabbath days the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless?
Right? You know what he's talking about right there? We're gonna end up talking about it for sure. Alright? He said how the priests profane the Sabbath and are blameless. What is he talking about?
Candle in the fire.
Book though, look, we cannot kindle fire on the Sabbath. Right? Guess what the priest did? Every day they had to keep that fire. Alright? Every day the fire had to be running. And you know what one know what's special? We're gonna read it. You know what? They had to do twice as many sacrifices on the Sabbath. Right? Any other day it's just, you know, the sacrifice. On the Sabbath, you read it, when we gonna get to it, you'll see it's twice as many on the Sabbath.
Let me make them in the fire anywhere.
That ain't work. You gotta slaughter an animal, lift them up, put them on there. Before you can't just put them on there now. You gotta drain his blood first. Then you gotta put them on there, cut him all up, because some pieces ain't gonna go on. Depending on what sacrifice, some pieces ain't going on there. Then some, depending on what sacrifice now, you might have to carry something outside of the camp and burn it. Right?
He
said, I'm working and my father's still working. Yeah, yeah, but why are you working on Saturday? He said, my father gotta do what my father do. He working. What you think the priest gonna do? The whole office of the priest, what you think they testify of? That's all y'all was doing. They work just like they father working. What they supposed to do? Like, nah, we all. When the last time you heard God say I'm off? Nah.
Yeah.
See, I was trying to get some sleep.
Perhaps he's sleeping. It's all in your God.
Right? That's the other God.
Right?
This is Matthew chapter 12. Where was that? We're going to get Luke now. Talk about the Sabbath.
For have you not read in the law how on the Sabbath day the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless?
Well, I told him. You know what I'm saying? Maybe they sleep. You know what I'm saying? Wake him up. Wake your God up. Come lick up this water. You know what I'm saying? Most of our God came down there so quick. You know what I'm saying? He mocked him, fool. All right, keep on.
But I say unto you that in this place it is one greater than the temple.
He says one greater than the temple.
But if ye had known what this means, I will have mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless.
Mm-hmm.
But the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day.
When was the last time you heard any God in the Bible say they had Lord of Sunday? We had talked all this stuff to the side. We got the man himself, all the people. Well, it's all about Jesus. Jesus himself just told you that he's the Lord of the Sabbath. He never told you he's the Lord of Sunday. Guess what they gonna tell you Sunday is, though?
The Lord's Day.
He just told you what day he's the Lord of, and then because of tradition, they gonna go against what he said. And that goes back to what Yahushua also said. He said, through the tradition of men, you make the law of God, the commandments of God, of none effect. A.K.A. you're making a fool of yourself. Right? Grab Luke. This is Luke chapter 4, verse 14. We know he's the Lord of the Sabbath. We just want to know what he do in his spare time on the Sabbath. Luke 4:14. Maybe I shoot through the.
And Yahushua returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about.
Mm-hmm.
And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up.
Mm-hmm.
And as his custom was.
As his what?
As his custom was.
What's the custom?
Tradition.
I mean, this. He said this is my tradition. What is it?
He went into the synagogue on the seventh day and stood up for to read.
I mean, it was my custom going in the synagogue on the Sabbath. Nah, that's my custom. I got to stand up. I got to read. Right? He spoke the word. He read the word on the Sabbath. That was his tradition. Right? Where we get Sunday from? I'll tell you, a Catholic. Right? You got these Christians all running around. You got to remember these Christians. These Christians, they learn the word from years like handing down. You know what I mean? Right? We was there and we taught the Gentiles. And from that, we went into captivity. So the Gentiles have to try to take what they learned from us. Remember, it's not expert. They're not experts. It's just like, at my job sometimes, we bring people in and we train. Right? So we, you know what I'm saying, we bring somebody in. And you'll have me, you'll have maybe my team lead, some of the other supervisors. We're experts, right? So we can train this class, come on in, break it open, I'll tell you where to find it, I'll show you how to work, right? But sometimes, we all call the way in meetings. So we have to put some of the people in the training class side by side with some of the people on the floor. So you get somebody who's only been there, you know, a few months, you know what I'm saying? Then you get somebody who's brand new, they just got there that week. Set them together. Just because we don't really have time at the moment to go over the details. So when we set them together, then, you know what I'm saying, at least they get to see somebody who's already working and they kind of have a feel for it. What happens a lot when that happens, though, incorrect information gets transferred. Or they'll be like, oh, but I'm not really sure myself, and they'll go ask. You know, that's a good question, let me go ask. Right? Imagine being in that scenario, but there's nobody to ask. Right? You start like, oh, well, I think this is how it goes. And you're going to see mistakes made. Right? That's what happened with the Gentiles. When we were taken away, so a lot of this stuff, like you listen to a lot of Hebrews, you listen to a lot of people in general, they'll make some type of scandalous, you know, Gentile purposely did that. I don't believe that myself, right? I don't believe a Gentile purposely did. I think the Gentiles made a mistake, right? They were in a position where they didn't have their teachers because their teachers went into captivity. So now they're in a position where they just got to come up with it on their own. Like, I think this is what it means. They wasn't well versed in the book. They wasn't learned in the scriptures. It's not like they had all that information on hand. All they knew is, well, there's somebody whose name is Yahushua. When you write it, it looked like Jesus. Right? That's all we know. You know what I'm saying? And I know that he died on the cross, and I know that he said everybody can get in. And I know that there's some Jews out there, you know what I'm saying, that don't believe in him, and I know that they won't. Right? So it pits them against those Jews. And then the ones that believe, they in captivity. So now it's like, what do we do? So they make it up, they figure it out, they do what they do. Traditions start to come in, and you get Christianity. Right? You get Christianity, you also get a merger of their holidays. Right? They have certain holidays that they celebrate. They celebrated certain holidays before our stuff came along. So then you say, okay, this is what I do to the God of Saturn, right? I put up a tree to the God of Saturn, you know what I'm saying? And I put a star on top, all right? And I put, you know what I'm saying? I like to deck it out and make it all nice and shiny and everything. I mean, this is what I do to the God of Saturn every year. Then all of a sudden, it's like, no, I don't worship Saturn no more. I worship Jesus Christ, right? That's what I worship now. So I'm going to start doing this to Jesus Christ. Right, because you don't have any structure. You don't have anything to be like, those shouldn't mix. You shouldn't do that. Right? You don't mix that. You know, you don't have. You just look at it like, well, this is what my whole family do. This is what we always been doing. The only thing that's really wrong with it is I'm doing it to that God. So I might as well just change the God that I'm worshiping. Right? That fixes the problem. If you don't have structure, if you don't know how, just like what we read now, we come out of Egypt and the Most High God take us through the wilderness for 40 years to get us clean from the pollution that we was in Egypt. If you don't understand that about God, and you don't understand how precise he is, and how serious he is about purification, then that means nothing. It's like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? I just worship, you know what I'm saying? I just, instead of having a star, I'm going to put an angel at the top of it. That fixes everything. Right? Everything is saying, I mean, but I'm going to just put that star, that thing, you know, that's for Saturn. Let me put this angel up there. Now, right, let me put a cross on it. Ooh, now for God. This for God. Jesus hung on the cross. Right, that's what we talk about. Jesus hung on the cross. Let me put it up there. Right, so you look at it, and we make those type of mistakes in traditions and traditions and traditions. Sunday, that was their day of worship. Right, that was their day of worship. The sun god and all that stuff. That was their thing. That's what they did. So Sunday, of course, that's where they would have had their day. Right, so you just like, okay, well, this is my, everybody. Together on Sunday, and we do our worship, but they just worshiping the wrong God. You know how I can do it? Everybody, let's worship Jesus on the same day. Let's do the same things, but let's worship Jesus Christ. Huh? The tree? The tree is not an engraven image. Not in itself, but you put an angel up there, that is. Yeah, you put an angel up there, you put a cross up there, that's an engraven image. Absolutely. Yeah, all that's idolatry. Right? The tree in itself is borderline, right? You know, it depending on how you, what you do with it, you're on the border, right? You're on the border. Any wrong step, you might be in sin too, right? But all of it is confusion, right? That's what it all starts with, confusion. Because you're not making clear what's acceptable to God, right? You just look at it and everybody attach stuff to God that's not have nothing to do with them. And that's what we fall into the problem with. Yeah, that's what that God has nothing to do with it. Rather, false gods have something to do with it. Right? And that's what our job is, to just make sure that we represent this is what's acceptable to God. And that way people will be able to have a point of reference. Where are we at? We've been about Luke. Ten Commandments. We started off with the first four last week, and we just repeated the Sabbath so we could pick up, you know, where we left off. So we went over the Sabbath again, and now we're getting into the last six commandments. So this is honor thy father and thy mother. All right? Why would Paul have to tell us about this? This is Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1.
Chapter what?
6, 1.
Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right.
All right? Notice he say, obey your parents what?
In the Lord.
In the Lord. All right? That means, in other words, when we say in the Lord, when you say walk in the Lord, what does that mean? Right? Everything that we do in the Lord means that we're within the confines that he gives us. He say, do this, don't do this, do this, don't do this. That creates a barrier around us, right? That's why he said, walk abiding, right? He said, stay within my circle that I'm providing for you. By doing this and not doing this, and doing this and not doing this, this creates a circle. If you within that circle, you're in the Lord. So if you obey your parents, you obey them that in any way that keeps you from disobeying God. Alright? Once it gets past that point, then that's different. That's why he's saying obey your parents in the Lord. Alright? Keep going.
For this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. That it may be well with thee, and you may live long on the earth.
Alright? So he said this is the first commandment with promise. Stuff like that, that helps us. We just read it, we may not notice that. Alright? But we look at it with that information, it's like, okay, well, this makes this one special to us. When we're gonna read through some of these commandments, you'll see most of God will play with the parent. Alright, let's go back. To the Exodus chapter 20, I don't know where we left off. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12.
Honor thy father and thy mother, that the day that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God gives thee. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his donkey.
Or anything that is
your neighbor's.
That's right.
And all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountains smoking.
Alright, so you have to understand, just so we can give proper context, what we just read, right, starting off with, thou shalt not have any God before me, right, going all the way down, so don't covet, right, all of those commandments were spoken by God from a mountain, right, a mountain that's super burning and smoke all over the place, it's thunder and lightning, all that stuff going on, and you hear this big voice coming out. Big scary voice. The more the voice speaks, then you have this all this fire. The mountain just seems like it's about to blow up, right? And it's speaking these commandments out of the mountain, and which each word is still feels like it's getting worse and worse and worse, right? So at the end of it, this is what we read:
and the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, and when the people saw it, they were moved and stood afar off.
Right? They start backing up. They're getting back. Like, man, what's going on? Right? They feel like all this stuff about to blow up. Let's see.
And they said unto Moses, speak thou with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die.
Right? It's like, listen, you talk to us. Don't let God speak to us, though. We don't mess around and die. So they, in other words, they told God to stop. They told Moses to have God stop. Right? So God's speaking Ten Commandments. The reason why this is important is because you'll have a lot of Christian theories, like the Seventh-day Adventists, for example. They would say that the only thing that we have to keep is the Ten Commandments. Right? That's what God originally intended to give the people. And the reason why they think that is because they don't understand the law. They don't understand what was given. They look at it and they see God spoke these ten. Right? So these are the important ones. Right? If you just do these ten, that kind of sums everything up for you. Alright? And that would make sense if you don't know, right? If you don't know the book and you don't understand why he only spoke 10, then that makes sense. So that's why it's important to point out the reason why he stopped is because the people start backing up. The people is like, oh, hold on, Moses, right? You holler, right? But think about it. The whole time, from the time that Moses saw called a burning bush. People in general didn't have any interaction with God. Only thing they had is Moses coming up to them like, yo, I just saw Yah. You know what I'm saying? He said, I am sin. That's what he told me to say to y'all, I am sin. Right? Yah, you know what I'm saying? The one that Abraham would tell us about. Y'all remember? Alright? Y'all remember him, right? So then they looking at him, they was like, man, we ain't going along with that bullshit, man. We got work to do, you know what I'm saying? And so then he's like, alright, let me tell y'all something. Right? Let me show y'all how this staff can become a snake. Oh, y'all ain't gonna believe that is. Let me tell you something else. Let me put my hand into my bosom, look, and it turned white. Right? Oh, y'all believe that? Okay, go ahead. Let me show you something else. You know what I'm saying? Let me show you how the water become blood. And then they believed him. Right? So he had to convince them through signs and wonders that I really did be Yah. Otherwise, I would not be able to do these things. Then after that, plague after plague on the Egyptians. People, believers now. They like, man, y'all really would do this. Right? Still, no interaction with God themselves at all. Then they split the Red Sea and said, okay, that's it. This God here. I rock with Moses. Moses right here, he working with God. So they cool. If you look at them, they cool. Whenever they got an issue, Moses go run, you know what I'm saying? Go do some praying. Most like God talk to him. He come back with some wisdom. So this is why they fine with that. They okay with it. It's like, all right, that's how it's always been working. So now you know when you don't have experience with something, you like, yeah, we want to talk to God too. You know what I'm saying? Everybody excited. Like, yeah, we want to hear from God. So he spoke to him out of the mouth. You start saying all these Ten Commandments. After that, they're like, whoa, let's go back to how we used to do it. You know what I'm saying? Like, you just talked to him, it was cool. We didn't know what we were talking about. You talk to him, you tell us what he's talking about. Grab Deuteronomy chapter 5. Excuse me, Deuteronomy chapter 5. They looking at, we don't want any dealings with what's going on. If he keep talking, we're going to die. That was the mindset that they had. They look at it backing up, the whole mountain about to explode, look like lava about to come out of it, because this fire coming out the top of smoke. So they looking like, logically, this just don't make sense. We didn't come way out here just to die. Right? Clearly, the Most High God don't know his own strength. Right? He's going to mess around and kill us. This is Deuteronomy chapter 5, this is verse 23. This is Moses talking. He recapping what happened that day to a younger generation. Right? Let's see.
Even all the heads of your tribes and your elders. Mm-hmm. And he said, behold, the Lord our God has showed us the glory and his greatness, and we have heard the voice out of the midst of the fire. Mm-hmm. We have seen this day that God does talk with man and he lives. Mm-hmm. Now therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us if we hear the voice of the Lord our God anymore.
Right? So they thought that the fire was going to kill them. They seriously thought they were about to die, so they stopped. They're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You go holler at God. Come back and tell us. This has been working for a long time. We thought this would be something cool. Look, we heard it. That's great. If you got anything else to say, you let us know. Right? You go deal with that bullshit. Right? We don't have time for that. Alright, let's hear about it. Let's hear how God felt about that.
Then we shall die. Uh-huh. Who is there of all flesh that has heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire, and we as we have, and live? Go thou near and hear all that the Lord our God shall say, and speak thou unto us all that the Lord our God shall speak unto thee, and we will hear it and do it. Mm-hmm. And the Lord heard the voice of your words when you spake unto me. And the Lord said unto me, I have heard the voice of the words of the people which they have spoken unto thee. They have well said all that they have spoken.
Alright, Most High God said, I agree. He's like, yeah, y'all said the right thing. You well said everything that you just said. You well said what you spoke. Alright, let's hear about it.
Oh, that there was such a heart in it that they would fear me and keep my commandments always.
He said that was a healthy fear. Alright? If you would stay like that always, man, it'd be alright with y'all. Alright? Keep going.
It might be well with them and with their children forever. Mm-hmm. Go say to them, get you into your tents again. But as for thee, stand thou here by me, and I will speak unto thee all the commandments and the statutes and the judgments which thou shalt teach them, that they may do them in the land which I give them to possess.
So you see that? The Most High God sent them away. He said, go back to your tents. But you, Moses, you stay your butt right here, and I'm going to give you all The Ten Commandments would have been everything that we're about to read. It would have been the whole thing that we're about to read had we not stopped. But we knew we were about to die. And it's not like God said, no, you guys weren't about to die. He said, no, you spoke well. Everything you said the right thing. That fire would have jumped out and consumed your butt. What do you think you're going to listen to the Most High God talk? Y'all lost y'all darn mind. You right. That's what was supposed to happen. It was about to jump out and kill y'all darn butt. You was supposed to stop. Right? You think you can deal with me without a mediator? Y'all? Oh, okay. Let me tell you something. Right? He said, yo, we well spoken everything that you said.
He was going to have the people that don't got the advocate.
What do you think when the Messiah come back, according to Revelation, right? It's a sword that he's going to be killing people with. It's a sword of what? Jethro said is that you take too much on you. Well, he didn't say those words, but you know what I'm saying? He was like, man, it's too much. You know what I'm saying? You got to judge for all these people. And the reason why is because the people would come to him and look for him to make a decision. Right? What God is doing now, he's giving us commandments along with judgments. So basically, he's telling us, if this happens, this is how you deal with it. Right? The same thing a judge would do. When you have something where you have some type of dispute, you go to a judge for him and tell you, okay, this is how y'all can fix this problem. Right? She owe you money. Okay, and you owe her services. Okay, this is what happens. If that's the case, you need to give her this, and you need to give her that. Right? So it's just a judgment, a decision, right? So that you can resolve this situation. So that's what we're about to read this one. He said, this is the judgment. You'll notice, whenever we're reading judgments, it's going to tell you, this shouldn't happen. If it does, this is what you do. Alright? Thou shalt not kill. Anybody who kills shall be put to death. Alright, so that's the, you shouldn't kill, that's the commandment, and then the judgment is, if you do, your butt's going to be put to death. Alright, so that's what we're about to be reading right now. It's important that we understand what the judgments are. These are the judgments. Let's hear about it.
These are the judgments which thou shalt set before them. If thou buy a Hebrew servant, 6 years he shall serve, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing.
Alright, he said, if you buy a Hebrew servant, I don't care nothing about the other one. But if you get a Hebrew servant, 6 years, that's all you got. On the seventh, let that butt go. Alright? Keep going.
If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself.
Alright? Don't try to come into, you know what I'm saying? You invite him into your house as a servant, you know what I'm saying? Don't try to, he can't go and woo your daughters and all that and try to leave out with all your people. Now, he said if he came by himself, that's exactly how he go after 6 years. Right? That's fair. Right? You came in, you can't come in and then leave with everybody in my household just because you're going free. You know what I'm saying? You come in by yourself, you leave by yourself. All right, let's hear about it.
If he were married, then his wife shall go out with him.
All right, if he came in married, his wife go out with him. Now, that's his wife. You know what I'm saying? He came to hold on to his wife, and I'm like, no, no, no. God don't mess with that. Let's hear about the next one now. This is the one that people cringe a little bit on. Let's hear about it.
If his master hath given him a wife, and she hath borne him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out by himself.
All right? Now, if he's a servant coming in, and then while he, after he became a servant, the master said, you know what, I'm going to get you a wife. At that point, anything that's produced from that marriage, that's the master's. The kids, the wife, all that. So you go, you know what I'm saying, bye, see you later. All the kids, your wife, that's all mine, right? All this is my property now. You know what I'm saying? It's still me. I still have responsibility over all this, right? I'm going to show y'all why that makes sense. Keep going.
And if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free. Then his master shall bring him unto the judges. He shall also bring him to the door or unto the doorpost. And his master shall bore his ear through with an awl.
Right.
And he shall serve him forever.
Right. So now he looked at it and he put him in a position. Now you have your wife and kid. Do you want to leave him or do you want to stay? Right. If he stayed, you know what I'm saying? And read that part again where he says stay. If he,
His master shall bring him unto the judges.
No, before that.
And if the servant shall plainly say, I love
shall,
my master.
Shall what say?
Plainly say, I love my master.
He got to plainly say. I mean, he can't be coerced. He can't be, nobody can try to say it for him. He got to be clear. No. I want to stay. It has to be his decision. Right? If it's his decision to stay, you know what I'm saying? Then that's cool. He can stay. But then he got to serve forever. Right? At that point, it's fair, right? I provided you a family and all that. You can leave. You're free to leave your family. And it's my responsibility to take care of your family at that point because I gave them to you. But if you do that, they stay. Now, if you want to stay, you can stay. We can all be a happy family together. But at that point, you got to serve them forever. Right? You give up the 7 year, right? You know what I'm saying? On that 7 year, you can go. You can give that thing up. Alright? So it's his decision. He has a big decision that he has to make. Right? Why do you think this law is in place? A lot of these laws that we read about is based off of something that previously happened in the book. Alright? For this one, we think of Jacob. Alright? We think of Jacob. Grab Genesis. Try to shoot through this real quick. Grab Genesis chapter 29.
Oh, came in by itself.
Genesis chapter 29, verse 15. Genesis 29, 15. Genesis chapter 29, verse 15. Let's see if we can try to understand where this law came from, why he put the judgment in place.
And Laban said unto Jacob, because you are my brother, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall thy wages be?
Right? So that's a very important, the reason why I went there, that's a very important statement. Alright? When we looked at the servant, we said, if you was a servant already, right? If you're a servant already, and then I give you a wife as a servant, that's one thing. But watch what his wages are for Jacob's servitude.
And Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel.
Mm-hmm.
Leah was tender-eyed, but Rachel was beautiful and well-favored.
Mm-hmm.
And Jacob loved Rachel and said, I will serve thee 7 years for Rachel, thy younger daughter.
That was a transaction, right? Laban didn't give him a wife as with him being a servant. That was a part of the transaction. You're working for me. Jacob didn't come in and debt to him. He didn't come in like, well, I owe you money, so I got to be your servant, right? Because I owe you money and I don't have it to give you. He came in, he good. He said, well, I'll tell you what, I'll be your servant for 7 years, you give me your daughter. That's it at that point, because that's the transaction. 7 years up, the transaction was, I got your daughter. Right? So he did it 7 years, right? And then he ends up giving them Leah instead of Rachel, right? He served for Rachel, right? He ends up giving them Leah instead. Then he told him, you know what? Go ahead and serve another 7 years. You know what I'm saying? You can get Rachel this time. It's just, I mean, from our parts around, we are. We don't give the younger before the older. Now, that's just not what we do. So I understand. I'm sorry if that wasn't communicated to you in the first. You know?
I wonder how much of that was like nonsense. Like, okay,
yeah.
Bro, you just
tried. Yeah, I'm saying, like, what?
Y'all
just
talk? Y'all said,
jump down the street.
Just
jump
down the street. Is that really his tradition? Or is he trying to switch it?
He's like, listen, you know what I'm saying? We just don't do that. We don't do that, right? Yeah, I know. I know you know, the Abraham went on down there in Canaan, you know, so y'all do some wild stuff in Canaan. But over here, you know what I'm saying? We don't do that. We don't get it the younger before the older. So he said, go ahead and fulfill her week. You know what I'm saying? Serve another 7 years, I'll give you break. So Jacob did it. You know what I'm saying? He served another 7 years, and then he ended up getting Rachel, and they started to have kids. But it's important to point out, in concerning the law, that was the transaction. Both situations, the transaction was, I'm going to serve you this specific amount of time, not because of debt, not because I owe you anything, because I'm gaining something from you, right? That was a part of the transaction. Grab Genesis 31, 36. Genesis chapter 31, verse 36. Genesis chapter 31, verse 36.
And Jacob was wroth and chode with Laban, and Jacob answered and said to Laban, what is my trespass? What is my sin that you have so hotly pursued after me?
Right? So this is after Jacob had served him about 20 years. And after that, he's like, I'm hot. Right? And I'm trying to get loose. Right? And after he got loose secretly. You know what I'm saying? Just kind of snuck out. And then Laban was like, what in the world? You got to think about it, Laban. It's important. Whenever, I mean, it's, you know, when you look at the Bible, you always going to have the protagonist and the antagonist, right? And we've been taught to read stories that way. So we look at Laban, bad guy. But it's important that we relate to everybody. You know what I'm saying? Because we, as sinners, could end up on any side of this thing. You know what I'm saying? In real life, right? So it's important that we look at Laban and say, what was he thinking, and how can I avoid that type of thinking? Right? When I feel that type of way, if I'm in that situation, how can I be tempted to do the same thing? Or to react the same way, or look at things the same way? So you look at Laban, you have to consider. Those are his daughters. Right? That's why when we talk my wife, sure. You know what I'm saying? But that's my daughter, though. Huh? I mean, gave you your wife. You know what I'm saying? But that's my daughter. You know what I mean? Then the kids that you have, they're my grandson. They're my kids. You know what I'm saying? You was my property at the time. You know what I'm saying? Then you leave. Cool. You're free. Why are you going to take my family? So that's how Laban built it. Right? Even though his came from the transaction, so he was supposed to eat that. He didn't eat it, though. You know what I'm saying? He looked at that. You know what I'm saying? That's my family. So Laban's like, you know what I'm saying? He's chasing them down. So Jacob was a little bit irritated by that. So he stopped, and that's why I say he chode with him. Chode just means, you know what I'm saying, he's fussing at him. He's yelling at him. You know what I'm saying? He's scolding him. You know what I'm saying? He's like, all right, so tell me. Why are you trying to follow me? You know what I'm saying? Why are you hotly pursuing me right now? What did I do other than stab you for 20 years? All right, he'll tell you. I said,
whereas thou hast searched all my stuff, what hast thou found of all thy household stuff? Set it here before my brethren and thy brethren, that they may judge between us both. But this 20 years have I been with you. Your ewes and your she-goats have not cast their young, and the rams of your flock have I not eaten.
In other words, he's saying, this whole 20 years, I've been good by you, and you profited from me. Right? He said, I ain't taking nothing from your hands. Right? Watch what else he said.
That which was torn of beast, I brought not unto thee.
Right? He said, if that thing got torn of beast, you didn't see me bring it to you like, hey, man, this happened. Oh, man, that lion just got to your sheep. It's hard. He said, I didn't bring that thing to you. What did he do?
I bear the loss of it.
He said, I'll apologize. I take my sheep, I'll replace it. Right? I got this, my sheep, this your sheep. One of yours keep taking my lion. That's messed up. Go ahead and take my sheep and put it over there. Yeah, you don't even know about it. You don't even know how many times lions they got at your stuff. I took it out of mine. He said, I've been good to you this whole time. Jacob, hot. He's looking at everybody, man. What you like? Why you chasing me? Why you searching all my stuff? If I, you ain't found that, put it in front of him. Right? He's busting that. He's chilling with him. Let's see.
I bear the loss of it of my hand that thou required. Stolen by day or stolen by night. Thus I was in the day the drought consumed me, and the frost by night, and my sheep and my sleep departed from my eyes. Thus have I been 20 years in your house. I served you 14 years for your two daughters and 6 years for your cattle.
Alright, 14 years for your two daughters, 6 years for your two cattle. Alright, keep going.
And you have changed my wages 10 times.
He said, you changed my wages 10 times. 10 times you told me that's what I was supposed to get, and that thing, I didn't end up getting what I was supposed to get. He said, that's ridiculous. Alright, keep going.
Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely you had sent me away now empty. God has seen my affliction and the labor of my...
He gonna send them away now?
Empty.
Notice what we have set up is exactly what God is saying doing in this commandment. Right? You give your daughter, you know what I'm saying, not necessarily your daughter, but you give them a wife, and the children that come, that's all yours. That's where he wanna go. Bye. See you later. But he empty. That's wrong. The only problem is, Jacob and Laban's situation was based off of the transaction, right? He owed him. He agreed, I'm only serving you for these reasons, right? That's what Laban messed up. He's supposed to eat all that. He's supposed to go, okay, well, that's yours, right? I'm not saying that that's mine and I'm giving it to you as long as you're mine. I'm saying this is yours, right? This is my daughters, they're yours. You know what I'm saying? My cattle, they're yours as long as you fulfill what you're supposed to fulfill. And Jacob did, right? But outside of that, there was nothing wrong with what Laban was looking at. He just, the beginning of it was wrong. Right? And then that set off everything. That's why it's so important to understand righteousness at a foundational level. Because otherwise, you get off and you try to get in the middle of righteousness, you think you're doing all right. It's like, nah, you was off from the beginning. You know what I'm saying? Your whole beginning was off. You know what I'm saying? You keep the Sabbath perfectly on Sunday. Yeah, that's where you're wrong. You know what I'm saying? That thing is, I mean, you do everything you're supposed to do on the Sabbath, but you do it on Sunday. Right? You look at everybody like, God can't be too bad at that. Nah. Right? It's the wrong day. So at the very beginning of it, you're wrong. Right? You 24 hours darn late.
You try to do a math problem like that.
It's never going to work. Right? It's never going to work. That's what it is. It's math. Grab a hard keyboard.
God has seen my affliction and the labor of my hands and rebuked me yesterday. Laban answered and said unto Jacob, these daughters are my daughters, and these children are my children.
Look what he said. He said, these daughters are what?
My daughters.
Hey, my boy, what's wrong with you? And these children are what?
And these children are my children.
Jacob can't even have the kids? He said, all this is mine. Right? Let's hear about it.
These cattle are my cattle.
Mm-hmm.
All that you see is mine.
Mm-hmm.
What can I do this day unto these my daughters or unto their children which they have born?
Mm-hmm.
Now therefore, come thou, let us make a covenant.
He said, let us make a what?
Covenant.
Let us make a covenant.
I and you, and let it be for a witness between me and you.
Mm-hmm.
And Jacob took a stone and set it up for a pillar.
Mm-hmm.
And Jacob said unto his brother, brethren, gather the stones. And they took stones and made a heap. And they did eat there upon the heap. And Laban called it Jeshur Shahidutha. But Jacob called it Gelly. And Laban said, this heap is a witness between me and you this day. Therefore was the name of it called Galeed. And Mizpah, for he said, the Lord watch between me and you when we are absent one from another.
Mm-hmm.
So if you shall afflict my daughters, or if you shall take other wives besides my daughters, no man is with us.
Right? He said this ought to be a watch that you treat my kids right. Right? Watch this. Jump back up to the whole verse. Verse 50. Give me verse 25. And we'll go back to 50. This is verse 25.
Then Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mount, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the mount of Gilead.
Mm-hmm.
Laban said to Jacob, What have you done that you have stolen away unawares to me and carried away my daughters, taken with the sword?
Right? So this is when he first met him. He chased him down. This is when he first met him. He's like, what you do? You stole away from me. Right? You took my daughter as cattle. Right? Remember, he's looking at it like, this is all mine. I'm supposed to keep all this. Right? Let's see. Keep going.
Before did thou flee away secretly and steal away from me, and did not tell me that I might have sent thee away with cabinet,
mm-hmm.
with myrrh, with songs, with tabard, and with harp,
mm-hmm.
and hath not suffered me to kiss my sons and my daughters.
He said, I couldn't even kiss my sons and my daughters. Right? All this still his. Right? Jump on down where he said, now watch between. Because that's how he's looking at it. He's looking at this. Like, these are all mine. You know what I'm saying? So he's like, yeah, God told me I can't say nothing good or bad to you now. That's the only reason I ain't getting at that butt right now. But, you know what I'm saying? Let this rock be here, you know what I'm saying? Serve as a witness. You do anything towards my daughters, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Let God judge you. Right? Watch what he said.
You shall afflict my daughters, and you shall take
this verse 50. It's Genesis chapter 31, verse 50.
You shall take other wives beside my daughters, and no man is with us. See, God is witness between me and you. And Laban said unto Jacob, behold this heap, and behold this pillar, which I have cast between me and you.
Mm-hmm.
This heap be a witness, and this pillar be witness, that I will not pass over this heap to thee. And you shall, and that thou shalt not pass over this heap. This pillar unto me for harm.
Mm-hmm.
The God of Abraham and the God of Nahor, the God of their father, judge between us.
He do what between us?
Judge between us.
He judged between us. Right? And that's what we look at in Exodus. In Exodus chapter 21, that's the judgment. Now, let me help y'all out. If this ever come up again, this is how we're going to handle it. You come in as a slave, you got a wife, that's your wife. Right? If you come in and somebody got to give you a wife while you're there, and that's the master's wife. But you can only work 6 years. After that 6 years, you're free. No matter what the scenario is. After that 6 years, you're free. So he cleaned up this whole mess that was made. He's like, listen, you a master. If you give him your daughter, you know what I'm saying? Right? After he's a slave, then that's all you steal. Laid it right in that situation. Right? Otherwise, if it's the transaction, that's his wife, right? Then that means he walked away with his wife. Everything he came in with, he walked away with. You know what I'm saying? To clean this whole situation up. You're not keeping him past 6 years. Not unless he wants to stay himself. If he wants to stay, he got to stay forever. Laban right with that. You know what I'm saying? So it's Laban right, Jacob right. Just depends on how you look at it. Right? Depends on how the situation plays out and what's agreed upon. Right? This is what the judgment, they prayed, they made a covenant. They said, let God judge us. Most High God said, sure thing, I will. Wait until Moses gets here. Sure thing, I'll take care of it. I'll clean this whole mess up. All right, let's go back to Exodus chapter 21. This is Exodus chapter 21. I don't know where we left off. This is Exodus chapter 21, verse 6.
His master shall bring him unto the judges, and he shall also bring him to the door and unto the doorpost. And his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever.
Alright, that's it. And it's important for us to recognize that serve what a servant represents. We think now, you know, kind of servant, we think of like slavery and all that. But it was much less slavery than it was slavery, but much less slavery as what we see as slavery based off of our history and what our recent history is more, it's closer to what we would see as just employment.
Like Alfred.
Yeah, like Alfred, like the
Batman's home.
What's the reference? Yeah, that's what I'm trying to think of. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Live it. Got taken care of. Had say so in the house. You know what I'm saying? Run him out. You know what I'm saying? It's like all that's what it was more like. It was servitude. It was a level of respect. Right? There was punishment in it too. I'm not trying to make it seem like it was all rosy and everything. But it was more like having a child. Right? As a child, you have that authority over them, and you can punish them. And it might be physical punishment. You know what I'm saying? You can do all these things. But it was like having a child. Right? We look at it as that's archaic. You know what I'm saying? Who would do that? But that's just because we live in a world now with corporations and all this stuff where they can employ all these people. Before you had that, you didn't have no corporate. It wasn't like there was a Walmart in the middle of Israel, you know what I'm saying, that was putting people to work. You had me, I had a farm, and you had you, and you don't have any money. If you don't have property, how do you eat? You have to go, you have to buy from people. Well, if you don't have property, right, what job are you working to get money? What are you selling to get money? You have to sell your services. So that makes you a servant, right? You walk up to people and you say, listen, I'll work in your field. You know what I'm saying? I just need you to do this. Or what happens if somebody can come up to you and they need some food? You know what I'm saying? They need some food and you're like, I got to pay that back. How do you pay that back? You don't have no property. He gives you some food. You agree that you have to pay that back. How do you do it? All right, I'll work in your field. You know what I'm saying? You feed me, I work in your field. I'll owe you. You know what I'm saying? So that's what happens. So you have these servants. Now, if you have much larger debts, some of us have, you know what I'm saying? We have larger debts. It's like something happens. It's like, oh, I just need to take out this loan. Well, imagine you have to do that, take out this loan from a family member or a friend. You know what I'm saying? But you agree, I have to pay this back. You know what I'm saying? Well, you'll work in their field. You know what I'm saying? It's longer. So it might not be just a quick, oh, working here for a week. Nah, I need you to work here for a couple of years. Books say if there's anything past 7 or 6 years, on the seventh, you're free. Alright, so that's what this is all about. And it applies to women too, that's what we're about to get into now.
And if a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the manservants do. If she please not her master who has betrothed her to himself, then shall he let her be redeemed.
Right, so he's saying that she should not go out as the manservant. And the reason why, what he's talking about there is a manservant. As soon as I'm done with him, you can go. Right. In this case, the woman, you can't do that. Woman, this is your option. You take care of her, or you find somebody to redeem. So you find somebody else to take care of. Right. You're not about to just put her out. Right? So he's saying you take care of her or you find somebody else to do it. Right? He's going to talk about his son too. Watch this.
If she please not her master who has betrothed her unto himself, then shall he let her be redeemed. To sell her unto a strange nation, he shall have no power.
Right? Book saying
dealt deceitfully with her.
The book say you can't sell her to just anybody either. You got to sell her to your people. Right? These are Hebrew servants that we talk about. So he's saying, you got to serve the your people. You can't serve them, you know what I'm saying? You can't just be like, okay, I'm going to put you on the market, you know what I'm saying, out there for the Greeks. Yeah, nah, that thing ain't flying with us. Nah, you can't do that. Right? Can't do that. You got to sell it to your people. You got to be redeemed. Right? Let's keep going.
And if he have betrothed unto her his son, he shall deal with her after the manner of darts.
Mm-hmm.
If he take him another wife, her food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall be shall he not diminish.
Right? So, I got to base her. I'm going to give it to my son to marry. Then my son was like, yeah, now I found something else. So I'm like, all right, well, you get to the curb. Nah, can't do that. You know what I'm saying? You take care of her just like she's your son's wife.
Just like she's your daughter.
All right? That's it, right? You keep all your duties to her, period. All right? Keep going.
And if he do not these three unto her, then shall she go out free without money.
All right? You got to give her to somebody else, and they ain't got to pay you a dime for it. All right? Now all your investment and everything you got is all gone. Right? That's what's important.
And the next person that get her gotta keep all those lost too.
Yep, absolutely. You know, so you gotta pick it up and all that apply to you. Alright, our whole culture was surrounded around taking care of our women. Alright, all our women had to be taken care of. Alright, there are scenarios where you have harlots and everything that for whatever reason end up being outside of that care. But the structure that we had was set it up that the women were taken care of. Right? A lot of people look at this and say, you know what I'm saying, they're chauvinistic and all that stuff. Like, hey, I don't know what y'all talking about. Y'all really know something good, they hit you in the dark.
They look for a man to take care of them now.
Oh. And the ones that ain't, you know what I'm saying, they got their own issue. Alright? Let's see, keep going.
He that smites a man so that he dies shall be surely put to death.
Mm-hmm.
And if a man lie not in wait, but God deliver him into his hands.
That's talking about who? Who smote the man so that he got?
Cain?
Cain, right? Cain smote his brother so that he died. He went to the Most High God. He said, man, you know what I'm saying? I smote him, but you know what I'm saying? You ain't got to put the mark on me now. Most High God said, don't worry about it. You know what I'm saying? Anybody kill you? You know what I'm saying? Sevenfold going to be on them. Have mercy on him. God came back and judged us. Now, he's like, you smite a man, your butt's gonna be put to death. Alright? Yeah, mercy on Cain. He came back, he's like, I'm judging that thing now. You smite a man, your butt's done. Alright? Keep going.
And if a man lie not in wait, but God delivers him into his hand.
In other words, if it wasn't intentional, right? He didn't do it when he hated his heart.
Then I will appoint thee a place where he shall flee.
Mm-hmm.
But if a man come presumptuously upon his neighbor to slay him with guile, thou shalt take him from my altar that he may die.
Understand what he said? We're gonna touch back on this later on in our history. He said, you will take him from my altar. In other words, what he's trying to say is, even if the man who did this murder is at the altar, making a sacrifice, praying. Right? Even if he's there, you pull his butt from there and put his butt to death. We're gonna deal with that later in our history too. Alright, keep going.
And he that smites his father or his mother shall be surely put to death.
Right? He said, he didn't say kill. What he said?
Smite.
You hit your mama and dad. Your butt put to death. He don't play with mom and dad. Right? He don't play with it. He said, even if you smite him, your butt going. You your butt is going. You could have been put to death. Period. That's it. Alright? Keep going. Mm-hmm. These are judgments, right? This is the commandment. If it's broken, this is what happens. Right? Keep going.
And he that steals a man and sells him, or if he be found in his hand, he shall surely be put to death.
Right? If you steal a man, you grab somebody, then try to, oh, who was that?
Joseph,
right? Grab Genesis 39. Genesis 37. Give me Genesis chapter 37. Genesis 37, verse 23. I'm going to miss Joseph.
To his brethren that they stripped Joseph out of his coat of many colors that was on him.
Mm-hmm.
And they took him and cast him into a pit.
They took him and they cast him into a pit?
And the pit was empty.
Mm-hmm.
There was no water in it.
Mm-hmm.
And they sat down to eat bread. And they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a
back to the command. It's Exodus chapter 21, verse, I don't know. It's Exodus chapter 21, verse 16. Watch what he said.
He that steals a man and sells him of it, he, or if he found in his hand, he shall be put to death.
That's a crime of death. Alright? That thing happened already. You know what I'm saying? When Joseph was, you know what I'm saying? Joseph, he ended up living from that, and he was in control. Right? And when they came to him, they was like, man, forgive us, don't kill us. They're supposed to die. He was like, man, don't kill us. You know what I'm saying? Our father said, forgive us. You know what I'm saying? I wonder if he really said. You know what I'm saying? He said, our father said, forgive us. Leave us alone. He's dead now. You know what I'm saying? Joseph was like, man, most of God do this thing. Like, y'all man, evil, but you know what I'm saying? It worked out for our good. All everything that we got right now, it worked out for your good because y'all did that. Right? You're like, don't worry about it. I ain't even got that in my mind. Technically, though, they're supposed to die. Most I die, he judging that thing now. He looking like, okay, you know what I'm saying? That was slid. He's like, nah, that thing happened, you killed him, buddy. Right? That's a crime of death. Right? Keep going.
He curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death.
Mm-hmm. You even curse. You even curse your father and mother. Lot of these kids be gone put to death. Lot of these kids be put to death. Right? LeBron James, he caught him on national television. His mom run his mouth and talking to him barely, caught him on national television cussing out his mom. That got that. Right? That they ain't got that. Most of God not playing with these people. I mean, if this was national law, you don't think this nation would be a lot more clean? You running, I mean, you can say what you want. Most of the time, ball came to play, people will line up. If we had some people upholding, you know what I'm saying? We had judges that are putting, nah, that thing gotta happen. You know what I'm saying? I ain't talking about nobody that be like, oh, well, that's different. You know what I'm saying? He just cuts like one, give him another chance. No, what the law said. That's it, you know what I'm saying? Go ahead and stone him. You know what I'm saying? I don't even want to watch. Go ahead and stone him. Nah, the book said you gotta watch. Okay. You gotta put your hands on for it. I gotta do it. You know what I'm saying? Then who's gonna work? You gotta go with that book. And then I bet you people straighten up. Because you people have love in their heart for one another. Right? You can't help but have love. You know that you're going to die. The other option is dying. That's crazy if you'd rather die than love your brother. Right? That's the whole book trying to teach you. It's good as death if you don't love your brother. That's crazy. These your people. It's good as death if you don't love. And I'm going to kill you. I'm going to make sure, I'm going to see to it that you die if you don't respect and love your people. It ought to be like that. That's right. Keep going.
And if
you want unity, I'll show you some unity. Tell everybody you're good at death if you don't unify under what God said. It's good at death, you kill it. That was Farrakhan talking about. Farrakhan said, if we dealt with Malcolm according to how we deal with people in the Nation of Islam, what business is it of you? You know what I'm saying? Farrakhan said, we deal with how we want to. That was our brother. You know what I'm saying? We feel like he did something wrong. That thing's good as that. Farrakhan's in the wrong religion, but he knows. He has a principle. You know what I'm saying? He just started off wrong. Same thing with these Christians that keep the Sabbath on Sunday. You know what I'm saying? You know that ain't right on the wrong day. Right? That's how it is. That's why Farrakhan can get attention. There's a lot of stuff he say is wise and is right. He can get that attention. Because a lot of it is right. You just in the wrong area. You just in the wrong direction. Right? Right? I mean, what if you got two things, you know what I'm saying? You got to go 70 miles an hour north. You go 70 miles an hour east. You're going the right speed, you know what I'm saying? You're going fast enough. If you were going the right direction, you would get there in time. But since you're going the wrong direction, you just going the wrong direction, extra fast. Extra fast. You ain't gonna never get there. Right? And that's what happens. That's why you can't climb up any other way. You have to go through the door. If you're not going through that door, you're a thief and robber. No matter how you spice it, you're not gonna get in. You can be doing all the right things. You know what I mean? You're just twisting the knob like you're supposed to be twisting it, but you're in the backyard. That's wrong. Damn, I get it. Like you're doing your movements, your angles, everything right. You ain't never gonna open the door because it ain't right there. dad at law instead of mother. You were perfect at your mom and dad. Yo, but dumb. Keep going.
And if men strive together, and one smite another with a stone, or with his fist, and he die not, but keeps his head his bed, if he rise again and walk abroad upon his staff, then shall he that smote him be quit.
Alright? Look, listen to what he said. We fight, right? Alright? We strap him, you know what I'm saying? Throw hands, I'll pick up a stone and just smack you with that thing. Fry it. Alright? Boom! You know what I'm saying? Debo knocked out, right? Okay, cool. That's good. If Debo get up, we good. Right? Debo got up. Guess what he got to do now? Let me see. Let's just think about it. This will stop some of us from fighting. All right? Let's see.
If he rise again and walk abroad upon his staff, then shall he that smote him be quit.
Mm-hmm. So he's good. He quit. That means that he's not guilty. You know what I'm saying? He's acquitted of the charge. Right? If you get up, you didn't kill him, you acquitted of the charge. So now he happy. Oh, man, I'm let off. Let's see what happens next.
Only he shall pay for the loss of his time and shall cause him to be thoroughly healed.
Right? You got to pay all the doctor bills and you got to pay any time that he missed work. Right? You pay for all that. Now, if it's worth it to fight at that point, go for it. You know what I'm saying? Knock him out. You know what I'm saying? Just make sure he's going to get up afterward and you take care of him. Right? No matter how you slice it, this ain't going to make you love your brother. You knock out your brother, you know what I'm saying? Boy, you can leave me alone. Alright, then, you know what I'm saying? Don't worry about it, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You go ahead and take that, you know what I'm saying? Hit you up with the doctor, you know what I'm saying? You good, I'll see you next week. Right? I'll take care of you, you good. What you gonna do about it? Alright, that's a book. That ain't right to me. They say you can't knock your brother out, you know what I'm saying? They say, after you get done, just make sure he alright. You know what I'm saying? That thing quit as long as he get up. Keep going.
If a man smite his servant or his maid with a rod and he die under his hand, he shall surely be punished.
Alright? You're going to be punished if your servant, you got a servant, you got a slave. You smite him and then you kill him. You're going to be punished, the book say. Let's see. Keep going.
Notwithstanding, if he continue a day or two, he shall not be punished for he is his money.
Alright? He continue a day or two, you good. You know what I'm saying? That's your money, right? You hurt your servant, that's the one less person working in your field. Alright? Keep that one in mind, though. We got a commandment to come. It's going to clean that one even up more. Watch this. People look at that and be like, man, that's out of mind. You can hit them, this, that, and that. All right, watch. You'll see something. Keep going.
If men strive and hurt a woman with child so that her fruit depart from her, and yet no mischief follow, he shall surely be punished according as the woman's husband will lay upon him, and he shall pay as the judges determine.
Right? So what he's saying is, if a woman is pregnant, right, and then men are striving, so in other words, me and Daniel fighting, you know what I'm saying? Then Tasha right there, she pregnant, God forbid. Right? And so we, you know what I'm saying? We get it in, and then one of us get knocked into Tasha. Right? Caused her to go into labor, so her fruit depart from her. I don't mean the baby dies, just saying that it caused her, you know what I'm saying? Once the baby is born, if there's any mischief, if anything is wrong with the baby, you know what I'm saying? Then that's one thing. But if nothing is wrong with the baby, what's going to happen?
He shall surely be punished according as the woman's husband will lay upon him, and he shall pay as the judges determine.
So even if nothing is wrong with the baby, no mischief, it was the fruit departed from her, and no mischief, no matter what, he gonna pay according to the judges, right? Judges gonna say, husband and the judge gonna get together and be like, man, but I'm thinking that. Right? And then whenever they decide, that's what's gonna happen to her. And that's when nothing happens. Right? That's when the baby is fine. Baby look like a regular baby. Boy, you put your hand on a woman. You mess around, y'all playing around. Y'all following the commandment a couple commandments ago. You know what I'm saying? Knocking out your brother about to take care of him afterwards. And then you end up bumping into a pregnant woman. He's like, yeah, no matter what, you get punished. No matter what happens, you get punished. But I mean, let's just see if the fruit depart from her and there is mischief. Let's hear about it.
And if any mischief follow, then thou shalt give life for life.
Life for life. So if the baby die, you die. Well,
eye for eye.
If the baby come out with one eye, you lose your eye.
Tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot.
And that thing a trap, because the baby definitely gonna come out with no teeth. That means all your teeth gotta be gone. Keep going.
Burning for burning, wound for wound, stripe for stripe.
Mm-hmm.
And if a man smite the eye of his servant or the eye of his maid that it perish, he shall let him go free for his eye's sake.
Right? So now we look at it, and you remember that one before, he said, now if you smite your servant, you know what I'm saying, and they die, you're going to be punished. Now if you smite your servant and they continue on, for a couple days, then, you know what I'm saying, you good. Nothing's going to happen to you because that's your money. But it comes back and it tells you, if you smite your servant in the eye, and they lose their eye, what happened?
He shall go free because of the sake of his eye.
You just freed him. Right? You just freed him. Nothing in this law is supporting slavery. The slavery that we experience. Nothing in this law. It just told you, if you steal a man and sell him, you're going to be put to death. Tell me how all of us good at that point. Every one of these slave masters would have been dead. All of them got us sold. And none of us said, hey, none of us signed up for slavery. None of them walked up like, yeah, you know what I'm saying, I wanted to get to America. You know what I'm saying? That's how the white folks got over here. And white folks, they signed up for that thing. It was like, listen, you get me out of England, you know, or wherever they came from, you know what I'm saying, I'll tell you what, I'll serve you for this amount of time. Right? They agreed to it. That thing was fine. Right? That was their people. When it came to us, they took us, they stole. From the inception, that thing was wrong. Right? Then they come back and they beat us, cut off our limb, poke out our darn eyes, rip off our arms, all that type of stuff. They're supposed to let us free. If that happened to us, you're supposed to let us free. That's the law. Right? Same Bible they're reading out of. Right? They're hypocrites. Ain't know that. They probably ain't even looked at that part of the Bible. People ain't there. Nothing about no book. Only they know about, you know what I'm saying, John 3:16, making a darn mess. Alright? Keep going.
And if he smite out his his manservants too, or his manservants too, or his maidservants too, he shall let him go free for his tooth's sake.
Right? So if you give him any injury that caused permanent damage, they gotta go. You know what I'm saying? They going free. Right? That's way different from what we look at. So if you beat up your servant, he don't die, right? He continues on. And then, after that, you realize he got permanent damage to him. He lost an eye, lost a tooth. You know what I'm saying? They free. Cured. No, you don't have no punishment. Also, that was your money, and you let him go free. Alright? Keep going. That thing just, if you ask me, that's law.
If an ox gore a man or a woman that they die, then the ox shall be surely stoned, and his flesh shall not be eaten. But the owner of the ox shall be quit.
Mm-hmm. So he said, if I got an ox and that thing end up killing somebody, is like, you know what I'm saying, we gotta kill my ox, but I'm not guilty of that. You know what I'm saying? My ox did that, my bad, oops, but you know what I'm saying, that ain't on me. Alright, let's hear about next one.
But if the ox were wont to push with his horn in time past, and it has been testified to his owner, and he has not kept him in, but that he has killed a man or a woman, the ox shall be stoned and his owner also shall be put to death.
That blood's on you now. Right? You die. Somebody, if you know you got a rough ox and you didn't keep him in, you didn't keep him restrained,
and
that's on you.
Testified, and people know about it.
Yeah, that thing on you. Same thing when you got a dog, you know what I'm saying? You got one of them dogs, just bad dogs, you got them in your backyard, that thing always escape. People already know about it. You've already been brought up to, you know what I'm saying? That thing already been brought to your attention. You still let them get free and they kill somebody?
Yeah, you dying too.
You and your dog. Keep going.
Shall be laid on him a sum of money, then he shall give for the ransom of money. Mm-hmm. Whether he have gored a son or have gored a daughter, according to this judgment shall it be done unto him. If the ox shall push a manservant or a maidservant, he shall give unto their master 30 shekels of silver, and the ox shall be stoned. Mm-hmm. If a man shall open a pit, or if a man shall dig a pit and not cover it, and an ox or a donkey fall thereon, the owner of the pit shall make it good and give money unto the owner of them, and the dead beast shall be his.
Right? So in other words, he has to buy their beast from
him. A dead one.
Right? Buy it. You know what I'm saying? Okay, I'll take it. You know what I'm saying? I put the pit. I didn't properly cover it. Y'all are irresponsible. That's mine. I keep them. Here go the money. That's what it costs. Go get you another one. Alright? Keep going.
And if one man that he died, then they shall sell the live ox and divide money of it, and the dead ox also they shall divide.
come up. You just look, that's how you're going to handle it. Right? And it's no way to cover, it's no way that he was trying to cover everything. Right? What he was trying to do is give us a foundation to where now the judges that were set over our people, they can make decisions based off of. So you could look at this, this is how God would handle this. So sure, it was an ox, but what if it was a dog? Okay. Since the ox is handled this way, we can handle a dog similar. Right? So you kind of look at it and you can build a foundation of how God is thinking about stuff just by knowing how he would deal with these situations. That's why these laws are important. So we get the mind of God. We get the mind, we get to see how God, what's fair to God. Right? How does he see things? Right? If you discount this stuff and you just push it out, you're like, oh no, it's done away with, you'll never know God. How you know him? Right? You look at it, you learn. This is what God is thinking. This is what God thinks is acceptable. Right? He thinks it's right that if I leave a pit open, that thing was mine, I didn't properly cover it, and an ox fall in there, he thinks it's right that I gotta buy that ox and then keep it. Right? Keep going.
Or if you know that the ox has used in time past, and his owner has not kept him in, he shall surely pay ox for ox. Dead shall be his own.
What verse is that?
36, 1 chapter 22 now.
Oh, we good. We can wrap up there. We'll pick up chapter 22 next week. Alright? But we look at it, these are the laws, right? These are judgments. We don't get through all the way through chapter 22, and then 23 are all going to be judgments. Then we're going to pick up 24. It's back to narrative. We'll read a little bit after 24 and figure out what's happening there. All right? But next week, we'll try to get through the rest of the law. We have two chapters of law, so we'll try to get through them a little more quick. And go through them and just kind of understand. This is the mind of God, right? This is righteousness to God. This is how things should be dealt with God. And after we get to those, a little bit of narrative, then we gotta talk about the priest, right? Sacrifice. You notice we didn't hear nothing about sacrifices at this point. Right? He didn't give us anything about sacrifice. These first laws is very clear what he just gave us judgments. Alright, so we learned a little bit about sacrifices and some of the other laws at a different time. Any questions?